Ray Steadman Allen is one of the most prolific and talented composers of Salvation Army music. As a son of Salvation Army officers, he was involved in music from an early age.
Initially, I was taught piano, and then I joined the local youth band and was taught the cornet, which I couldn't play very well, and moved on to the trombone subsequently. And I really expanded from then on. Sheer interest and the subject just possesses me. I worked on my own quite a lot, read a lot, listened a lot, thought a lot, and then finally took courses and so on and went into the conservatory style, finally reaching my doctorate, so that was quite good. But initially I was self-taught, you could say, as Elgar was. The first time I heard anything that I'd actually written down was that my father wanted to have one or two hymn tunes in his own meetings. And so as I was been studying scoring, he asked me to do them. And the first things I ever heard was our local core band at Battersea playing the tunes I'd score. I was thrilled to bits with that.
In his long career, Ray Steadman Allen, or RSA as he's now affectionately known, has written over 400 works, many of them becoming standards in the Salvation Army world. However, early in his career, some of his work was considered too daring, ahead of its time.
There were some people who thought that my writing was ahead of its time. I think it was because I brought another language, or slightly newer language, being young. I found it easier to be under the influences of the more contemporary, and I brought that into what I was writing. So people would say, this is a new voice. I sometimes wonder whether you come in the cracks, because somebody says, you're writing before your time, and then about 30 years later, you're old-fashioned now. So where is the point in the middle?
As a young man, Ray got a job working for General Evangeline Booth.
Well, I was number two office boy to begin with and number one office boy subsequently. We're going back now to about 1938, a long way back. And she was a very lovely lady. My job was not terribly important. It was mostly changing the blotting paper and making sure her very special pens were on her desk when she wanted it. But it was an exciting time because that was at the hub of the Salvation Army itself. It's all happening there.
In 1942, he enlisted in the Royal Navy and was demobbed in 1946. 2 years later, he entered the William Booth College. It was here that he met Joyce Foster, the person who's been by his side for the last 63 years.
Do Isha as well, if I can. This is where I proposed to my wife. I met Joy when she was a fellow cadet in the International Training College, as it was called then, the William Booth College for Officers. We came in quite independently. We didn't know each other. And there was, I think, somewhere a mutual spark there somewhere. Quite unofficial, you're not supposed to do it. So we were very good. We tried to go by the book and toe the line, but the gleam was there, and that's how we got together. We got married in June 1951, and we got married in the Regent Hall. We had a big reception at the Polytechnic. We were overcome, we couldn't eat much. So we actually sneaked away from the crowd, crossed the road and went into a Lion's Corner house and had mushrooms on toast.
Our RSA's creativity has been instrumental in guiding the course of Salvation Army music, not only as a composer, but also in his role as leader of the International Editorial Music Department between 1967 and 1980.
If I were to be asked if there's a piece of music I was the most proud of, it would be very difficult to do that. I'd rather think on the vocal side, a piece called My New Day I'm very fond of. On the band's side, they tell me that the one that was regarded as groundbreaking was a piece called The Holy War, which was written in the 60s, early 60s. I think lots of them have special value for a particular aspect or particular incident, but I could mention those two pieces, I think probably, as pretty significant. There were some moments that I remember with special fondness. I think probably certain performances would come back, and also the joy of seeing our own family move in the same direction. Barbara's a vicar now, but she's a trombonist of some dimension. Rosemary plays the flugelhorn. They're both pianists, and they're both creative. That brings a lot of joy to a father, and they're hoping that the grandchildren will go the same way.
In 2005, Ray Steadman Allen was awarded the highest honour given by the Salvation Army, the Order of the Founder.
On this particular occasion, we were going to a concert at the Royal Albert Hall, and Joy said, we'll get your uniform cleaned. And I didn't know why, and I thought something is afoot, but I never thought of that. And I was quite stunned, but very excited. Humbled, you'd have to say that, because you think some of the other people who've had the Order of the Founder have been great people. So I was very excited, but humbled. I think that'd be the way of putting it. I don't do very much composing at the moment. Joy is not too strong, and so I tend to be more of a carer for her. But I do try to keep going, and I'm told it's quite good at being 91 to be able to come up with something. So I like to write. If I feel I want to write, I go for it. Concentration is difficult for long periods, that's all, yes.
On his 90th birthday in September 2012, Ray's achievements were celebrated at Regent Hall, the place where he and Joyce were married in 1951.
We were married here, stood here.
Ray chose this occasion to pay homage to his family, especially Joyce.
Every night, when it's possible at home, she goes to bed early because she has Parkinson's, as you know. She goes to bed. I play the piano to her. I play the piano to her, a couple of pieces, always ending with "Now the day is over." And then I read a bit of a book. And then she tucks up and goes to bed. I'm going to play that tonight, if I may, for her. "Now the day is over."
It's been well worth it, because I think I've made so many friends, moved into so many circles. You tend to forget all the tough times and the criticisms and the snipings, which come to everybody. Put your head above the parapet. If I were to give a message to musicians, I would say do keep your priorities right. Take pride in what you do, but don't think more of yourself than you should. It's a great thing to be involved in something bigger than yourself, whatever it is. Try and find your role and stick with it through whatever happens, even through the criticisms. Go for it and stay with it. My legacy, I hope it would be, without sounding pompous, on the technical side, a love of craftsmanship in the service of the highest things I know, which are both cultural and religious, of what only the best would be good enough. And also the fact that I encouraged quite a number of new writers in the Salvation Army who have now moved on to maturity and say thank you for the help you gave me when I was a young struggling student. So I would feel that was a good legacy.